Dr. Cicelina Ledbetter, Professor of Psychology in the Division of Social and Behavioral Sciences in the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host for A Healthy Mind. The purpose of this television series is to educate and keep our community informed about mental health, from public policy and environmental factors to the various disorders that affect healthy minds. Get Out, Dunkirk, Split, Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri, La La Land, Hacksaw Ridge, I Wanted It to Be Billionaires, and Fences are all recent popular movies with a psychological twist and turn. My guest on this edition of A Healthy Mind is Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, a licensed clinical psychologist whose interest lies in the intersection of psychology and media. In her soon-to-be-released book, Best Psychology in Film, Dr. Marshall Woods explores the psychological dynamics found within the 2017 Academy Award-nominated and won films for Best Picture. She regularly consults with screenwriters, documentary filmmakers, and authors to accurately integrate psychological aspects into plots and provides character analyses. She's lent her talent and expertise to a number of media outlets such as News Channel 8, In Transition, NPR, and The Huffington Post. When she's not on a movie set, Dr. Marshall Woods serves as a professor at the George Washington University, faculty with the Washington School of Psychiatry, and assistant director of psychology at the Psychiatric Institute of Washington. She has a private practice in Washington, D.C., where she works with individuals, children, and families in psychotherapy. She joins me to discuss her new book, Best Psychology in Film. That sounds great. So by now, you know, I love movies. I don't get to see many, which is, you know, really bad. I got to get a life. I got to get out
That's
more.
That's why you're not watching a lot of movies.
No, because I have a life. No. Yes. Yeah, my father used, you know what my father used to say? And I think that this is it. This is like that delayed trauma stuff. He would say, don't watch them. They've got jobs. They've got it going on. You figure out what you want to do. So yes. That's my trauma story. I'm carrying that because that's part of the reason why I don't watch much TV. But I want to do more because I feel so inadequate when I'm sitting with you talking about all these really juicy movies. And have you seen the Manhunter piece?
I have not.
Okay. So, but that's what you do. So tell us how, Dr. Marshall Woods, how you got into doing work with psychological thrillers, because I think that for every psychologist / movie buff, we think that's who we are, right? We kind of play that in our family. So tell us about how you got started with doing consulting with psychological thrillers.
Sure. Well, historically, I've been interested in film and in movies and television and media in general. But when I became a psychologist, individuals were interested in having me on TV shows like this to talk about various psychological topics about mental health, etc., which I love, but I also have a passion for being behind the camera as well.
Yeah.
Early on in my life, I was trained in television. So for me, being behind the camera feels more comfortable.
Okay.
And when I began to think about the skill of using psychology, I feel like psychology is all around us. We don't necessarily conceptualize that psychology is around us, but with every thought we have individually, any interaction we have with someone else, we are interplaying something that is psychologically researched and even supported. And with the amount of media and television and film, I mean, films gross about $11 billion a year. And that was, you know, several years ago. Wow. So clearly, there are individuals who invest in watching and spending their time in watching film.
Yeah.
And so why not marry psychology with film and being able to say what you're watching is actually a lot of psychology.
Yeah, $11 billion. That's a lot of money. They probably got like $45 for me in the past year. I've got to do better. But so I bet that when you first started, you were doing a lot of free work.
Sure.
Did they come to you and say, hey, what do you think about? And you were just like, yeah, this is my work. I have to figure out a way to turn this into, right? Because it's really interesting and everything is psychology. And the fact that we sit in front of the tube, whether it's film or television, we're in front of some media. Many of us, six, seven, eight, right, hours a day.
Sure.
So.
And on smartphones, even more.
Yeah, yeah, don't say that. We're all guilty, right?
Yes, we are.
We are all guilty.
It is always a part of our lives at this point.
That's right.
Unless you actively, consciously choose otherwise.
Right.
Media is even when you pump gas at times, there's a TV screen that's
talking
right
at
there.
You. Why yes. are you trying to fill up?
Yes, it's always present.
That's right. This
platform can be very influential on how people understand the world around them and understand how they are a part of the world.
And that's why it's really important what you do. I think it's important because even in having this conversation, you're teaching us to be conscientious viewers.
Yes.
Because everything that comes at us on film is sending a message.
Yes. Yes.
And sometimes it goes directly to your subconscious, and other times you get it.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And so I think what you're doing is really, it's masterful.
Thank you. It's masterful art.
So thank you for your contribution.
Thank you.
So let's talk about these wonderful films that came out. I actually did see a couple of these films this year. So I'm kind of proud of myself. I went to a couple movies. Let's talk about La La Land. I liked La La Land. Did you like La La Land?
I loved La La Land. Actually, and a confession here is when I first watched La La Land, or even prior to watching it, I wasn't necessarily captivated by the trailer. So I thought, oh, this is going to be a great musical. But then when I watched it, and the amount of times I have to watch it to be able to write about it,
right. It
was actually hard letting those characters go because they were so rich in the way that they were written.
Yeah. You know what the masterful, in your book, do you talk at all about the masterful reflection? Because I think that the way they use, what is that, time lapse or time...
Yes.
The way they use that, I thought, was brilliant.
It was.
In a way that I got it, because usually I don't.
Yes.
But I got it in La La Land.
Yes, where you're able to see the character's perspective, not as something that's globally happening always between the two people, but then they take you away from that and place you in the mind of just the one character and what their perceptions were when interacting with that other character.
Yeah, and what's really fun is that you can get like a 5 to 7, because it feels like a long time, but it's not.
Right.
You can get like a 5-second flashback and like 2 hours of the story gets filled in for you.
Yes.
Like what just happened? Okay, this is why. And that happened all throughout the movie for me.
Yes.
I didn't think, because when I first saw it, I thought, cute musical. I used to play in musicals. This is cute. Why? Because I waited to get, until they got the award, right?
and then watch it.
Yeah, I went to see it. It was worth it, though.
Mm-hmm.
It was worth it.
Yes.
So, so when you think about the character development, which character in La La Land was most difficult to let go?
I think for me, both Sebastian as well as Mia, they both were very rich in different ways.
Mm-hmm.
You have this young lady who is exiting emerging adulthood and still trying to accomplish what emerging adulthood is meant to do,
which is
be able to determine what do I want to do for the rest of my life, commit to a career, and feel some level of success in the career that she's chosen.
Right.
And we see her really struggle with that. And then we see her boyfriend, who is passionate and committed to his art of jazz, and how he won't let it go. And people are trying to say and convince him to let it go, and even provide him opportunities that are very financially attractive to let go of his dream.
Yeah.
And so for me, it was really interesting to see how emerging adulthood, when people are struggling to accomplish and to succeed in knowing who they are as an adult, what that conflict is like for them. And for her, she says, I'm just gonna move back home and forget about acting again.
Right.
And because this opportunity came about after she put everything on the line for it, for her, knowing that, and for parents especially, when your child comes home at 26, this isn't a failure. This is still emerging adulthood.
That's right.
This is an extension of what we used to believe was late blooming.
That's right.
This is pretty normal now development.
That's right.
And so I think being able to watch Mia's journey through learning who she is and staying committed to her dream, And knowing that she had the support of her family, when families watch their children return to their basements or their childhood bedrooms,
every day.
Yes, that this is typical, normal, and an event in their lives that can be supported rather than saying to the child that this is not how their life is supposed to happen or they have other responsibilities now.
Right.
We are learning that emerging adulthood is much longer than what we once thought.
That's right.
And so how can we as parents support children who come home like this?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting perspective. I hadn't really thought about it or looked at Mia from that perspective. But I think you're right, and I think every sort of zeitgeist defines, you know, as we move through the world and move through time, the patterns with which we, you know, exist. They kind of change.
They
it was
change.
In the past. It was, you know, at 17 or 18, you get out of my house, you're not coming back.
Correct.
You know? And now with millennials returning home right after college, instead of deciding that they're just going to keep moving forward and doing their thing. I think the movie did illustrate that beautifully, although, you know, that's a gift that you've given me because I didn't share that takeaway. I was like at the bottom of the barrel. This is where I was living. I was like, I cannot believe that they didn't get together at the end of the movie. I was so heartbroken.
Exactly. So this is another perspective,
right,
which is, what does love really mean?
Right.
Is it enough to actually let someone go,
right,
to pursue their dreams?
Yes.
And does love end just because you are no longer with that person?
You know,
that love can carry on for decades or scores later,
right,
and that doesn't mean that you're necessarily with that person.
Right, right. It's a big lesson, right? That's huge.
That's a huge
because
lesson.
Isn't that huge? It's like, even though they had made conscious decisions to move on with their lives, in the flashbacks or the flash forwards, I can't remember now, it was clear that they still had the connection.
They still have a connection.
Yeah.
And then the question is because you love someone, do you always have to decide that this is the person who you will be with
the
timing isn't there for them?
Yeah, and at least once, you know, in my classes, at least one person in each class will say something like, do you believe in soulmates? And then I have to dance around that. But I think the movie really spoke to that because I thought that they were setting it up for them to have all this spat and then come back together and be soulmates and get married and all of that.
Yes, that would be nice.
That's why they got nominated, because that was not the plot.
That's not the plot, right?
They
bring you on a twist of that.
They did. Mm-hmm. They did. But they didn't let the love go.
They don't let the glow go.
They let the physical go.
Exactly. Which in many times, individuals experience that frequently.
Right, right.
And is that okay to be able to live your life separately but still carry on the love of someone?
That's right. I think it was a really powerful way to show that love doesn't always mean what you think it means.
Exactly. It's another alternative to how you handle life.
It is another alternative. It is. And I think it was pretty healthy.
Absolutely.
I think it was pretty.
Yes,
I didn't like it.
Because the romantic individual.
I wanted it to be romantic.
Right. It's that you want them to end up together, and you're hopeful, and you know so much about these characters. You're invested in these characters, and you're invested because of the richness of who these characters are.
Right.
And you've seen them throughout time. You've seen them develop. You've seen them mature.
Yeah.
They become a part of the landscape of the movie.
That's right.
And so, of course, you want it to end just the way that you desire it to end.
That's right.
But the love is still there.
The love is still there.
It's still a positive ending.
It is a positive ending. Yeah, it was positive. I didn't want it to, you know, I had to have to reconcile that. So Fences.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yes.
I saw Fences.
Very quick plot
is
that you have an older gentleman who is in his later years, and he has a teenage son and a wife, and he has a job where there is discrimination because of race, and he has experienced discrimination throughout the course of his life, where he wanted to play baseball and was unable to do so, and he feels it's because of the color of his skin.
Right.
However, there were other variables that may have stopped him from doing so.
Right.
And so now we have a wife who is hearing this always, her husband really disappointed with life and disgruntled about his life. Right. And we have him who's struggling with how to navigate and how to fight to be a black man in society and be able to raise a black teenage boy.
In Pittsburgh.
In Pittsburgh, the society in which he felt very discriminated
right.
in. And then we have his young son who is saddened by the relationship that he doesn't have with his father and the relationship he does have with his father.
Yeah.
And trying to say things have changed. And his father's saying, not so fast here. Things haven't changed so much. And so we see this conflict between these characters of love.
Yeah.
Dad is disgruntled and upset and hurt by the discriminations he's experienced.
In life.
And he loves his son enough to communicate this right. to him, to protect him.
Right.
But his son feels that his father is nearly traumatizing him.
Yeah.
He articulates, when I walked in the room, I would kind of shake when I would see
yeah.
because of the presence that his father had, which wasn't loving and warm and cozy and fuzzy.
No, it wasn't.
But it was also, as his mother described, was the way that he loved him.
Mm-hmm. I think way too many, I don't know, don't you think that kind of characterizes a lot of the relationships for black males? I mean, I'm saying black because I don't know how the white males would. I could just say males and their sons. Mm-hmm. Don't you think that some of that, what you saw in that movie, characterized a lot of that energy that you see?
Yeah.
Like, I know, you know, he knows I love him.
Yes.
I don't need to say it.
Exactly.
Or I don't need to hug him.
Mm-hmm. And actually, within the film, they actually describe this very well. There's
yeah.
a part where Denzel Washington communicates to his son when he says, you know, why don't you love me?
Yeah.
Paraphrasing.
Yeah.
And he says, that's not really what I've signed up to do. I've given you this
right.
life, and really is to help him to be able to survive in this environment.
Right, right, which is a very different kind of love.
That's a very different kind of love. It's
yeah.
in what we would consider more primitive. We need you to survive
yeah.
rather than to self-actualize in this environment,
right.
which
right.
is very different, and the expectations would be very different. And for his son just wants his father to be loving in the way
yeah.
that he wants to receive love.
Yeah.
And his father, unfortunately, was incapable of that. It
yeah.
was unable to provide
yeah.
him with that.
And I think the there was also a piece that was not lost on me, that in loving someone, that character in loving his son may have traumatized him.
Correct.
Right? In a
yes.
way that, you know, just the, you know, I'm just loving you from what I have. I don't see it as abuse. I don't see that I'm doing anything wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just raising you the way my daddy raised me, right?
Right.
But not loving him in the way that he needed to be loved, and not maybe reading the tea leaves and kind of tweaking it and giving him what a little bit of what he needed, kind of felt like trauma to that character.
Exactly. And, you know, for Denzel Washington's character, he describes his history of his relationship with his father, who actually he separated from when he was a preteen,
right.
a teenager, and he didn't necessarily have his father's influence for the remainder of
right.
his childhood years. And so just him being there for his son was very different and supportive in comparison to the life that he had,
wow.
even though that necessarily wasn't the good enough parent that the son needed.
Right, right. So in the book that you're working on, did you talk any about Viola Davis's character?
I did.
You did? Okay.
I did.
Okay, so I'm curious about, because I think that her character was really intense.
Very, yes.
Right? It was very intense. It had lots of layers.
Yes.
And I think that it felt like five people in one.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yes.
She had not, you know,
right.
it just felt she was able to be this, and she was able to show up in this space, and she just kind of did a masterful job.
Yes. She was the individual who was able to keep the family together.
Yeah.
Including Denzel Washington's brother and his relationship with him.
Yeah.
She was able to keep the son close to the father
yeah.
and the father close to the son. When Denzel Washington's character actually committed infidelity in the relationship. She was the individual who took the child and kept the child in the family once the individual with whom he had an affair with died.
Yeah.
She was the individual who was really the connecting link for the entire family. Yet, with that responsibility came such a burden for her that actually meant that she consciously put aside specific dreams hopes and love that she also desired.
And that was sad. That made me sad.
Yes.
Because she was so self-sacrificing that she didn't really live.
Correct.
Like, it didn't feel like she lived fully.
Yes, until at the end where we learn from her character that she was okay with her decisions.
Right.
She noted that her husband gave her a home where she could sing, and that's what he provided for her. Right. And somehow she was able to reconcile the dissonance between all of the responsibility she had and be able to make peace with it at
the end.
And
I think you have to do that. Well, I think it's healthy.
It's healthy.
To do that.
Difficult,
It's really difficult. I mean, particularly when the issues that your partner makes are living with you. And that happens more often than not. Like the woman makes the decision that I'm gonna take this other child into the home and raise this child as our own, even if the mother is alive, right?
Sure,
and something's wrong with the mother. So I think what's really complex about her is that she does get to the point of not being a bitter woman.
Correct.
She doesn't make that choice.
So she makes the opposite choice of her husband, where he struggles with these emotions of being bitter and being hurt and feeling like the world has assaulted him in some way.
Right.
So she decides to take the opposite end of that decision.
She did.
So now her son is able to see here are different options and alternative ways to being able to cope with a very similar situation. Mm-hmm. Both of their dreams were sacrificed.
Yes.
And here's a woman who was able to resolve that within them, and here is a man who struggled for the duration of his life in being able to deal with that conflict.
Yeah, and I think the thing that also resonates from this film is, despite the fact that she did acquiesce a lot, like she gave in a lot, you never felt that she was weak.
Correct.
Right?
Yes.
You never felt like she wasn't ready to just lay down the law and do what needs to be done.
Correct.
It was like it was all very conscious, which I think was just remarkable.
It was remarkable. And that, I think, speaks to her ability to confront conflict. Mm. Even when things were not going her way or she would see something that happened in the home, she would say something about it. She wouldn't let it go underneath the rug or not be able to handle the situation, she would speak what her mind brought to her and feel confident in doing so, even though she may have not been rewarded and received the benefits of that, where she would advocate for her son, just sign the paper so he could play sports.
Yeah,
and even though he didn't, at least she was able to articulate, that's what I want for our son.
That's right.
This idea of him having an affair with her, her saying, you know, I'm not okay with that, and them not speaking for quite some time, but saying to him, it's not okay. You've walked around for years being bitter like this because I too have self-sacrifice.
That's right.
And she was able to communicate these very difficult, heartfelt, emotional, tearful moments, which I think speaks to, you know, Viola Davis's talent in general.
Yeah.
But the script also lends itself for that ability to communicate your thoughts even during difficult times and still not reaping the benefits speaks to a strength a person has.
It really does. It does. So tell me your favorite part, right, of the book so far. I know it's you're writing it. Like, which piece are you enjoying the most?
Outside of the writing.
Is it difficult?
It is not difficult. It's a labor of love and a pleasure because of my passion of film and movies. And I think what has been the most passionate part for me is that I haven't had to tailor it only to psychological thrillers. We see psychology in every movie.
Right.
So I've been able to explore these dynamics and use recent literature in psychology to be able to support these concepts or not support these concepts of what we see. So for me, it's been such a pleasure being able to bring psychology in this way to other individuals. So I think
all of it.
The process has been really gratifying, and I can't wait to share it with everyone.
I can't wait to see it. I can't wait to read it. We have like 2 minutes,
okay.
but you know what? We have got to get split.
Split. So historically, individuals really struggle with seeing dissociative identity disorder, the formal multiple personality disorder, on television, and people would say, you know, this is just Hollywood, etc. Now, granted, there were Hollywood moments.
There were.
I mean, there were parts that were fantastical. He's climbing a
wall.
So,
yeah,
of course, that's not necessarily going to happen, or at least I have never
that
seen.
Wasn't your part.
Yes,
that wasn't your contribution.
But I feel like Split in particular shows how individuals shift between ego states. And he's in therapy.
Yes.
This character is receiving therapy, and how the relationship with the therapist is someone who's very supportive of him, who is not afraid of all of the ego shifts that he has, of all of these different personalities, I say. However, she was an advocate for him. And actually, that relationship of saying, an individual who has dissociative identity disorder, or DID, they're not scary individuals. Honestly, it's a good film to be able to articulate. Many times this disorder comes from a history of trauma.
Right.
And so this is an individual who have experienced significant distressing pain and an event or chronic events that has happened in their lives in order to shift the way that they are able to even hold on to themselves in a constant state.
Well, I tell you what, you have definitely shifted the way we, the viewing audience, me, the way we're going to look at film from this point forward, because I think that your work is really amazing, really intriguing, how you dig into those characters. And I really look forward to reading your book, in Film.
Best Psychology in Film.
Best Psychology in Film. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
If you'd like more information about Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods or her soon-to-be-released book, Best Psychology in Film, you can contact her at psychmindedmedia@gmail.com. If you'd like to aspire, accomplish, and take on the world in the field of behavioral sciences, consider pursuing a degree in the field of social or behavioral sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. You can learn more about the psychology program by visiting the university's website at www.udc.edu. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser-Ledbetter, and if you'd like to reach me, visit me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Dr. Cis. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time on A Healthy Mind.